I'm Ashutosh Varshney, director of the center, and it's a pleasure to start this year with Professor Sukhdev Thorat. But if in March, early March, someone had said that all our events, our classes, our seminars would be virtual for months and months to come, perhaps you would have dismissed that as a dystopian thought. But that dystopia is a pragmatic necessity today. Right through the semester, our events will be virtual, and we are not sure whether seminars can return to an in-person setting in the spring semester either. Our smallest classes now can be in person. Those who are at Brown know that. Our smallest classes can be in person, but any class that's larger than 20 is compulsorily virtual. And it's not clear, as I said, what will happen in the spring. Data and science will guide us. But here we are in a virtual setting. But this virtual setting has a silver lining. Namely, we can invite speakers from South Asia to participate as speakers, as well as part of audience for our events, which was not easy earlier. Now, via Zoom, everyone who is registered can watch our events, can hear our speakers, and we can also have speakers from South Asia, as today's speaker is. Professor Sukhdev Thorat is a major figure in the study of agricultural economics, poverty, exclusion, but is of course very well known for teaching us, enlightening us a lot on issues concerning Dalit economics, if you will, and discrimination against Dalits in India and what's been happening in which part of the country. The one paper that I remember very vividly was the experimental work he did with some colleagues at Johns Hopkins on whether corporate sector in India in its recruitment practices, exercises or practices of discrimination. The rules, the Zoom rules should be announced beforehand so you know what is expected and how we will proceed. You can send your questions beyond Brown, the Brown audience that is here. Beyond that audience, you can send your questions only via chat function as a text message. And then then Arushi Kalra, who will be conducting this this whole event after I quit in a couple of minutes, will pick and choose questions for and comments for Professor Thorat. This is a student-driven seminar event. We invite our students to participate and also co-lead some of the seminars, and this is one of those. So let me hand you over now to Arushi Kalra, who has curated this and who has who on behalf of the center would be leading this event for the next 95 or 100 minutes, 90 minutes. And she's a PhD student in economics here at Brown. And so let me invite Arushi now to continue with the proceedings.
So thank you, everyone. A very good morning to everyone, and thank you for being here. I'm going to introduce Professor Sukhdev Thorat and then very quickly hand it over to him. Professor Sukhdev Thorat is an economist who has worked extensively on issues related to rural poverty and agricultural growth, marginalized groups, the caste system, the cause of Dalits, tribes, and denotified tribes, minorities, and education through his writings, lectures, and work with organizations. He specializes in agricultural development, economic institutions, and development, poverty, social exclusion, and inequality, economics of caste and economic discrimination, market discrimination, labor market discrimination, and Baba Saheb Ambedkar's economic thought in his previous roles at the Jawaharlal Nehru University from 1973 to 2014, and as the director of Indian Institute of Dalit Studies from 2003 to 2006. He was the founder and director of the Indian Institute of Dalit Studies. He was also the chairman of the University Grants Commission from 2006 to 2011 and of Indian Council of Social Science Research from 2011 to 17. He has been awarded honorary DLit, DSc, DS, and LLD degrees by various international and national universities in India. In 2008, Professor Thorat was awarded the Padma Shri, India's fourth highest civilian award, Mother Teresa International Award, and recently Baba Saheb Ambedkar Ratna Award by Delhi government for his dedication and extraordinary contribution on the works and thoughts of Dr. Ambedkar. In today's lecture, Professor Thorat will discuss graded inequality, market discrimination, and poverty. The concept of graded inequality is described by Baba Saheb Ambedkar in his own words, and I quote, "One striking feature of the caste system is that the different castes do not stand as a horizontal series all on the same plane. It is the system in which different castes are placed in a vertical series, one above the other. This is the principle of gradation and rank." Professor Thorat will demonstrate how the system of graded inequality is perpetuated in a market economy by bringing data to the table. So now I would like to hand it over to Professor Thorat. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Arukshe. Let me begin with thanks to the Center for inviting me to speak on caste, market discrimination, and poverty. It is indeed nice to see Ashutosh Varshane here. I knew him and I knew his location here, but I'm happy to see him here. Then there are other person, Simon Lawrence from Brandeis University, Milind Auswarmal from New York, who is the president of the Ambedkar International Mission. Thank you very much once again. Let me begin with the topic of, that you have given to me for discussion, the graded inequality based on caste, market discrimination, and its consequences for poverty. Before I go to this central theme, let me make some preliminary remark that why we are even concerned today, despite the fact that the Indian Constitution accepted the principle of equality and non-discrimination, and yet we are concerned about the caste. The caste discrimination was the topic suggested to me. I think the reason is, I would like to quote Deepak Lal, who wrote a book called Hindu Equilibrium in 2 volumes. And there is a very powerful sentence he has used. And he said that the hatredness for the caste system is because of the immense inequalities that it creates. That's the reason that we are concerned with the caste. But now that we have a very secular framework and regulatory framework, why are we concerned about the caste once again? The reason is that if we look at the framework laid down by the caste, its traditional framework laid down by the caste, it was based on the principle of equality, inequality in economics field. It laid down the rules regarding the right to property, right to education, right to occupation and employment in an unequal manner, and a and the inequality. The inequality formed the principle of governance of the caste system in its economic sphere. But it's not a simple inequality. It is a graded inequality, which is slightly different from that of inequality with a bipolar extreme, you know, haves and have not, or poor and non-poor. The graded inequality, Arushi has rightly mentioned about the concept that the caste system allocate the economic right among the different castes in a graded manner, which means that if you go down in the caste hierarchy from Brahmins to the untouchable, the economic rights reduces one after another. And the untouchable who are located at the bottom of the caste hierarchy practically have no economic right. Now, as I said earlier, that we have now a regulatory framework which is based on equality and non-discrimination. The Indian Constitution completely overturned the regulatory framework laid down by Manu. But the concern comes from the fact that the past does not remain past. It come alive in present in some form. To put it in Dr. Ambedkar's word, that the living with past in the present or living past. Now, this is the concern, that the de jure is not de facto altogether. And therefore, there is a carry forward of the earlier system into the present. And it affects the people's their access to the property, access to employment, access to education and other sphere. And therefore, the concern is that the caste continue to influence in modified form or a new form and affect different communities, different castes differently. It is because of this reason that we discuss the caste system and its legacy. Now, therefore, today, what I will do in the present discussion is that I will first present you the evidence on inequalities, economic inequality in a graded manner in the Indian caste system by taking a latest data from the National Sample Survey and other official sources which came very liberally through me to my researcher in the Indian Institute of Delhi study, thanks to them. And then I will address the another issue, second issue, is what are the sources of this inequality, if inequality persists between the castes, and particularly the inequality between the untouchable and the high caste, what are the reasons behind that? Now, I will argue, I'll finish this portion, preliminary remark. I will argue that the economic inequality, particularly between the untouchable and the high caste, including OBC, is partly because of the consequences of the past denial to the economic right to the untouchables, right to property, right to employment, right to education. And that past legacy continue partly because the failure of the state to correct those inequalities. The access to the capital asset and education has not, the gap in the access to property right and education has not been reduced. So the policy is one of the reasons. The past legacy continues to greater extent, and I provide an economic I'll provide an empirical evidence on this continuation. But the second most important reason is that besides this past economic inequality in the sources of income and employment, the discrimination which continues through the market exchange, market transaction, in accessing the property right and employment and wages is one of the reasons why the disparities continue. So in a way, to put it in a brief, past exclusion, which has not been corrected by the government with respect to ownership of capital asset, and the continuing obstacle in the market and non-market institution is presumably the reason for the inequality and high poverty of the low caste communities. Now, so let me go to the
empirical evidence of this on these two questions. But before I do that, I would like to spend about 5 minutes on the concept of the caste system and the economics involved in it, because that will serve as a proper background to our discussion. But I will have to be very brief. Now, the traditional economic regulatory framework of the caste system, as you all are familiar as a student of caste, involves division of the people into 5 groups, the Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, and the untouchable at the bottom. It divides the people, but it also assigns economic rights, right to property, right to employment, right to education, and it assigns the rights in an unequal manner. That's a very simple, and everybody knows that. And it put restriction for any mobility for change. So the economic rights groups, caste, in terms of economic rights and functions, remain segregated. So there is a caste segregation as far as the economic functions are concerned, and the interaction between the two different group is limited. So there is an economic exclusion, as it were. Now, this is the provision in the Purushottama Rigveda. Maybe about the historian would argue, those who have worked on the caste, it was about Rigveda was about 1,000 years before the Christ, first century, and it continues till Manu emerged on the scene. And Manu brought the changes in the regulatory framework with respect to economics, at least. We will go into other things. And this aspect needs to be remembered very clearly, that Manu is supposed to have framed Manusmriti sometime around 200 BC. And Manu only brought one important change, that the fixation of economic rights into 5 categories, 5 castes, without any freedom for a change. He introduced a flexibility into that. And that is that limited flexibility is the following, that in the event of distress, in the event that high caste are not able to earn a level of living through their own occupation, then in that case, the Brahmin could resort to the occupation of Kshatriya, Vaishya and Shudra, that is agriculture. The Kshatriya could resort to the occupation of Vaishya and Shudra, and the Vaishya could resort to the occupation of Shudra. So that flexibility has been given, and this flexibility is very important, because eventually, as you find, this flexibility has become almost a rule. And the riddle that how come you have large number of Brahmins as an agriculturist, and even Kshatriyas into business, the reason historically you will find in this relaxation rule of relaxation in Manusmriti. But there was no any concession for the untouchable. Untouchables at the bottoms, their main job was to serve the 4 castes above them as a wage worker and as a slave and as a serf. The Hindu slavery is known to us. It began with Manusmriti. There is evidence there. And it continued till 1843 when the British banned the slavery. So untouchable were in fact literally the slave caste. But there was a small concession that was given to the untouchable by Manu, and that is that if they are in distress and they are not able to survive because of wage labor, they can work with the Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and the Shudra. In the traditional rule is that the untouchable is only required to serve the Brahmin. He is the servant of the Brahmin. But now the small concession is given that if they can't survive by working for the Brahmanas, then they can also work with the Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and the Shudra. This is the only rule that has come into being. So I think this concept, I thought it's possibly necessary to get a background. Now, one more point I will mention about the status of untouchable, and then switch over to the empirical evidence. Now, we can see that the occupations are segmented across the caste. Without any freedom, they remain hereditary by birth. As far as the untouchable was concerned, this also means, the earlier rule also means that the caste cannot work in the occupation of the other caste. that is the important characteristics of the caste system. But there is an exception for the untouchable. That is very important. One has to remember that if there is an exclusion of getting involved into the work or the occupation of the higher caste, for each of these castes, the situation of untouchable is slightly different. That their participation in the wage work or labor is characterized by both inclusion and exclusion. Exclusion in the sense that they are not allowed to work in a better quality work in the occupation that the Brahmin does or Kshatriya do or Vaishya carry or Shudra carries. They cannot be also self-employed farmer or trader, get into commerce. So the better job, they are excluded. But at the same time, as far as the manual labor is concerned, they are in fact required to work in all the four castes as a manual labor. On the contrary, I would say that it is a forced labor in a way. So on the one hand, they are excluded from the better work. On the other, they are included. And I think the Amartya Sen has very beautifully described this as unfavorable exclusion and favorable inclusion. Unfavorable inclusion, rather the forced inclusion. And the untouchable also are excluded simply because they are polluting caste. They are not allowed to engage into occupation which comes into that direct contact with the high caste. They are also not required to, they are not allowed to work in the activities that involve religious function or domestic work, cooking and other things, even at that point of time. So exclusion also occur in this activity. But there is also activities which are forced on them, like scavenging and work related to leather and all that. So this this exclusion inclusion of the principle which determine the labor of the untouchable need to be understood clearly. Now with this background now, let me dwell upon two questions. First is, I will discuss with you the graded inequality at the present level, at the present time, drawing from the recent data, whichever year the recent data is available. I will take, we can certainly study the improvement in the well-being of the different castes and the people by taking the indicators of human development. That's the standard measurement of human development. And there are three indicators which are used, income per capita, literacy, and the life expectancy. A converse of that or opposite of that is the human poverty index, which has been promoted and developed, in which we take the percentage of people below poverty line, illiteracy, malnutrition, and the death rate of the people and malnutrition of the children and the women. Now, if we take this indicator, then what we discover, because I would not go into the detail now because it will take time. I have circulated two papers to the participant and you can look at the data. Now, if we take the indicators of income per capita, that is monthly per capita consumption expenditure as a substitute for income per capita, if we take poverty, if we take malnutrition, and in malnutrition you can take death rate, you can take percentage of women suffering from anemia, underweight women, we take child mortality of different types, neonatal, average, natal, under 5 mortality. We take the three other concept of malnutrition, stunting, wastage, and underweight. We take the data on the housing, and also we take the civic amenities data, such as the availability of electricity, availability of drinking water and drainage in the locality or houses of the scheduled caste and high caste. Now, if we take all these indicators, and I am not giving you the statistic for a simple reason, that there is no exception whatsoever in any of these indicators to the graded inequality. What we discover is the following, that the income per capita is the highest for the Brahmin and it goes down to OBC and and the untouchables. I'm not taking the religious minority. I'm confining to the Hindu society, caste society. So there are only three castes, scheduled caste, OBC and high caste. So if you take the income per capita, it's the highest among the Brahmins, goes down to reduced to OBC, and then it is lowest among the untouchable. You take poverty, The behavior of the poverty is just the opposite of that. You take malnutrition, same story, like the story that you have for the poverty. Civic amenities. Now, this is a very, very convincing empirical evidence that the caste, the degraded inequality still persists today despite very, very progressive policy for the scheduled caste and for other marginalized groups, which means the way the economics of caste system was framed by the Brahmanical theory of caste system, it was such strong that it could not shake, the government policies could not shake, or even for that matter, the market transition could not shake that basic graded inequality. The reason is that the restrictions operate in the market for transferring the property right or hiring or employment or wages and exchanges in input and sale of output in by the farmer and by the in the entrepreneur. So that is the picture that we get, which is a very disturbing picture, that the untouchable which suffered for centuries, we do not see much improvement as far as the relative ranking is concerned. There has been an improvement in their life. There is no doubt about it. Poverty has reduced, education has improved. There is a little bit of improvement in the ownership of land and ownership of enterprises. But if you take the distance and the gap between them and the high caste and them and the OBC, they remain at the lowest level as such. So let us come to the second question now. Why is it that degraded inequality still persists? Now, I had mentioned my hypothesis in the beginning that the access to that there are two reasons for this graded inequality, and I'll provide the evidence, empirical evidence for that. Namely, that the continuing disparities between the caste in the ownership of capital asset, which gives you income, such as land, entrepreneurship, disparities in employment, access to employment, disparity in education, which decide your employability and your chances of getting employment. These disparities still continue despite several government policies. And therefore, that became the unequal access to the sources of income and education became the reason for creating the inter-caste inequality between the caste. But the second reason is that even if we take equally placed high caste and low caste and untouchable, equally placed in terms of all the qualifications, we find that the situation of the untouchable, particularly vis-a-vis OBC and high caste, is still worse, which means that there is a discrimination. They are treated differently, although they are on par with the high caste. So the discrimination in the market and outside the market, but particularly in the market, in accessing employment, in exchanging property right, in land or business, the untouchable face discrimination. These are the dual reason for the inequality, caste inequality, but particularly the lowest situation of the untouchable. Now, the economists have developed the techniques whereby you can measure the gap. You can measure the gap between the high caste and the untouchable in income, in employment, in wages, and in occupation. And then, if you take a gap, if you have a gap, how do you explain that gap? The economists have developed a technique that you can decompose that gap into endowment factor, that is not having access to ownership of asset, ownership to capital asset and education another. You can decompose that gap attributable to the endowment factor, but at the same time, you can also you can get a component of discrimination, which means if you take income level, and there is a gap of 150 rupees or $150. To what extent this 150 rupees gap is because of the endowment factor that I don't have sources of income, not enough education, and to what extent it is because of this discrimination? Although I am placed on par with other, and yet I am discriminated. Now that is the method which is used by the economics to identify the magnitude of discrimination in the market, in various market, employment market, And there is another way is, of course, to conduct the primary studies. Now, therefore, I will briefly share with you the result of my empirical estimation, and that will bring us to close of this lecture so we can take answer questions. We take income. We take income, that is monthly per capita consumption expenditure. We take gap between the monthly per capita expenditure of higher caste and scheduled caste, and scheduled caste and OBC, and run the decomposition exercise, two exercises. One is the scheduled caste and the high caste, and the scheduled caste and the OBC, and try to see there is a gap, and to what extent the gap is because of endowment or factor, endowment differences, and to what extent it is because of discrimination. This data is for about of 2012. Latest data is not released by the government because the poverty has increased, income has gone down, or at least remains stagnant. So government is uncomfortable. So 2017-18 data is not released. We take the 2012 and 2011 and 12 data. It doesn't make much difference because the figure are the same. Now, what we discover is that there is a gap between the high caste and scheduled caste to the tune of ₹1,119. Now, this gap can be decomposed into endowment factor and the discrimination. And what we discover is that 60% of difference between the high caste and the scheduled caste is because of the endowment factors, that the scheduled caste have less ownership of land, enterprises, they are less educated, and the unemployment rate is very high. So the resources that are required to earn the income, 60% are accounted. But nevertheless, and between OBC and OBC and the scheduled caste, again, the endowment explained about 65% of difference between their income level. Now, if we look at the statistic, if the lack of ownership of capital asset is the reason, then we can look at the statistic and find out the empirical evidence on the lack of ownership of property right among the scheduled caste. We have the latest wealth survey, that is 2013, and that will give you the idea and disparities between the ownership of wealth by the scheduled caste and the high caste. In 2013, almost 65% of the country's wealth is owned by the high caste, almost twice their population share of 21%. The OBC own about 31%, which is fairly close to their population share of 36%. The SC, however, own only 7% of country's wealth, much less than their population share of 16 or 17%. So you can see the disparities in the ownership of wealth altogether, that include land, building, and financial deposits. If you take the per household wealth, similar disparities were brought out. The average wealth at all India level is rupees 15 lakh. It is 25 lakh, 29 lakh for the higher caste, 13 lakh for OBC, and 6 lakh for SC. The SC's average value of wealth is almost 6 times less compared with the high caste, and 2 times less compared with the OBC. So you can see the graded inequality. I forgot to tell you the meaning of that. OBC own more than SC, but almost 2 times less compared to the high caste. Thus, the graded inequality, which is the core feature of the caste system, has not broken much despite the equal rights and free market. This affects their occupation pattern. So there are less of self-employed farmer or entrepreneurs among the scheduled caste, and they depend heavily on the wage labor. For example, the proportion of wage labor is about 44% among the scheduled caste compared to 26% for OBC and 11% for high caste. So you can see that inequality in ownership of wealth is quite clear. If you come to education, and if you take the enrollment ratio in higher education in 2017 and 18, it is 25% at all India level, but it is 19 for scheduled caste, 26 for OBC, 38% for high caste. Without fail, the graded inequality continue and persist in this. Now, so you can see that I have given only two examples. there could be more indicators that one could take and see the differences in the endowment ownership. But as I said, that discrimination also plays the role. We have seen that 39% of difference in the monthly per capita consumption expenditure between scheduled caste and scheduled tribe is unexplained. And therefore, the 39% difference is attributed to the discrimination that the scheduled caste face. And 35% is differences when we explain the difference between scheduled caste and the OBC. So you can see that, let me summarize and conclude on this point, is that the differences in the income, the gap in the income between high caste and scheduled caste and between scheduled caste and OBC, about 36 to 39% gap is mainly because of discrimination that they face in the market, although they are equally placed when they involved in exchange. Now let me come to the individual market. I'll only take the labor market. That is very important because 60% of the scheduled caste, for example, are wage laborer, both regular salaried and casual laborer. And therefore, the labor market outcome for them is very, very important. I would only summarize by saying that the scheduled caste face a very high level of discrimination in hiring, employment, in wages, and allocation of jobs once they are employed in the factories and the production process. Now, let us come to the employment. Most surprising aspect that we get is the very high level of discrimination faced by the scheduled caste in the employment. Of the total differences in employment rate between the scheduled caste and the high caste, almost 71% are explained by the discrimination. And only 29% is because of endowment. And endowment essentially means education as far as the employment is concerned. This is the level of discrimination that you find. And I will only say that the level of discrimination is much higher in the private sector as compared to the public sector. Similarly, the story for wage discrimination, but it is an opposite trend. That is, endowment explains 71% of difference in the wages between the high caste and low caste, scheduled caste, and discrimination explains about one third. So the wage is largely determined by your education level and skill, but about one third of it also determined by which caste you are belong, what is your social identity. The discrimination in wage is high in the private sector also. There is one important point that I will mention, and on this point is that the discrimination in the public sector is in the wages is higher at the lower end job as compared to the upper end job in the public sector. But in the private sector, the wage gap between the scheduled caste and the high caste is much higher on the top level jobs and much less at the bottom level job. So you can see the nature of the discrimination. There are restrictions that the scheduled caste faced in getting a job in the upper hierarchy in the private sector. Now, last point about the labor market I'll take, and I'll stop it here and move over to the other topic, that there is also a discrimination between job allocation. That if you are hired, in any case, with the lower wages, you are allocated the jobs which are not in conformity with your qualification. So there is a discrimination. Now, if you look at the occupation pattern, I have not discussed because of lack of time. If you look at occupation pattern, there is a huge segregation and concentration of the scheduled caste in elementary occupations and construction. That is part of it is because of discrimination in a belief that the scheduled caste are not as competent as the other are. So this is the, you can see that let me summarize now that the gap, the disparity between the scheduled caste and the high caste and the scheduled caste and the OBC in income and in employment and wages and occupation, a part of them are because of the discrimination. But most significant aspect of it is that a very high level of disparities in employment are because of discrimination in hiring. Now let us come to the primary surveys. My institute, Indian Institute of Delhi Study, did a survey of discrimination of three markets. One is the labor market, in which we have taken, for example, casual farm labor, casual non-farm labor, and we have taken the regular salary. and then we have taken the business, and then we have taken the farming. So there you have three occupations. Now, I would not like to go into greater detail, but I will just summarize, and I hope you believe me, because some of these result of this are reported in the book Blog by Caste, and you can verify from there. But there is other book that is coming up, so that will give you detailed result of this. As far as the wage labor are concerned, both casual, farm, non-farm, and regular salary, there were about, I think, the wage labor household sample was 441, non-farm was 389, and regular salary was 314. Invariably, in all these three cases, we discovered a discrimination in various form. I cannot go into greater detail, but denial of employment, paying lower wages, discrimination at the workplace, the untouchable being asked to sit separately for lunch, and other things. In business, there were three categories of business were taken in the rural area. This is a study for rural area. This is not on urban. In rural area, three occupations were taken: restaurant, grocery shop, and the taxi and auto rickshaw. In all the three, we saw discrimination being reported by these people who are engaged into the business. The grocery owners told us that their demand is normally, their consumers are normally confined to their own caste. In a rare cases, the high caste will come and buy. And if at all they buy the packed good, not the open good. Similarly, restaurant, they share us quite clearly that their customer are only the person from their own caste. High caste won't come and eat noodle or something eatable from the scheduled caste shop. A similar experience were shared about the taxis and the auto rickshaw. They reported that the high caste generally prefer the use the taxis and the auto rickshaw by their own caste. There are variation. The proportion we have to see, it is not 100%. It is 40%, 50%, 60%. But discrimination exists in various degrees. As far as the farmers are concerned, the farmer faced discrimination in purchase of land and sale of land in the agriculture for agriculture purposes. They faced the discrimination in getting land for the houses in the high caste locality. There is a complete segregation of the residences of high caste and the low caste. Then they face discrimination in buying of input and selling of output. Generally, they tend to give higher prices for buying the input from the high caste dealer, and they receive lower prices for their product. So you get a discrimination in this market. Now, we can only say that this has adverse consequences. Now, the theories of discrimination, there are quite a several theories. Common point that emerged from this study is that there are negative impact on them. That is very, very important. Discrimination result into less ownership of a capital asset, so that the capital gains are income is less. Discrimination in employment, wages and occupation result into lower wage income, and lower wage income then turn into the poverty, high poverty. The discrimination in the farming, we have a separate paper on farming. It result into low productivity, farm productivity, high cost, and the net low profit. And in the entrepreneur that we have seen, the sale will be less. As a result, the income will be low and the profit level will be much less. There is a book by Ashim Prakash who has studied 90 Dalit entrepreneurs, and he brought out the problem faced by them. So this is the impact that we can see. Now, for 2017 and 18 employment data, we have assessed the impact of the discrimination in employment and wages. But I would not like to share that study. There are two co-authors, but it's very, very clear that the discrimination in employment and discrimination in wages and occupation result into lower income, and it increased the poverty. I think for 2004 by about 7% and 2017 by about 19%. So that is the impact. Now let me summarize now. I will summarize only the policy implication of this study. why we are in this state of affair. My opinion is that the inequality that persists between the untouchable and the high caste, and the untouchable and OBC, and OBC and the high caste. Also, there is a gap between the OBC and the high caste. But since there is no literature on economics of discrimination of the OBC, we have not done that exercise. But that is an independent area which we should study. There are indications that the OBC certainly face discrimination, if not the kind of discrimination that the untouchable face because of untouchability, but they do face discrimination, but we require studies. We require studies on Muslim also and religious minorities. Therefore, I have confined to untouchable and OBC and untouchable and high caste simply because there is enough literature to build up an hypothesis and then test it empirically. Now, my argument, my feeling is that the inequality persists simply because of two reasons. One is that the government has not undertaken policies to bridge the gap in the ownership of capital asset like land and entrepreneurship between scheduled caste and high caste. And that gap still continues. There is a marginal improvement. Land reform has completely failed as far as the untouchables are concerned. The proportion of landlessness is very high. Similar policies are not strongly taken as far as ownership of enterprises is concerned. You have to look at Malaysia, how they have developed policies to increase the ownership of share and equity and business of the discriminated group of Malayas. But we have not done that. Only recently we have done something. That is the procurement policy, a reservation for the scheduled caste in government purchases. So that's the one of the reason I think feel is that we have not adequately compensated. We have not gone into the redistributive justice to the untouchable in terms of paying, terms of improving their ownership of asset, even in education, as a compensation, because they were denied this right, but at the same time, these rights were overwhelmingly given to the higher caste. So high caste had access to land and entrepreneurship and education at the cost of the untouchable. So untouchable lose and high caste gain. The government has not taken very strong policy. That is the one reason. And secondly is that even as a safeguard against discrimination, two policies are undertaken by the government. One is legal safeguard. That is, practicing discrimination is against the law. So Untouchability Offence Act of 1955 and Prevention of Atrocity Act of 1989. So there is some space there for the economic discrimination, but not much. We have not really specifically passed the law for discrimination in employment, wages and occupation, or discrimination in employment in land market or capital market or housing. And as a result, there are not enough safeguards for the private sector, as a matter of fact. And then affirmative action policy, which now gives some space in government jobs to the scheduled caste and in education, is confined to public sector, a vast private sector. Today, I think public sector account close to one fifth of the job. The entire 80%, more than 80% jobs are in private sector, where there is no safeguard against discrimination in employment or wages, or there is no safeguard against entering into the entrepreneur, taking an entrepreneur as an occupation. So the private sector is completely free from any safeguard to the untouchable. And therefore we see the discrimination in employment is of a very, very high order. Therefore the implication, policy implications are quite clear, that you will have to improve the ownership of the scheduled caste with respect to land, entrepreneurship, an improvement in education. And as a matter of reparation or compensation, there are arguments now which are being developed that there is a case for reparation, compensation to the untouchable, because the high caste benefit at the cost of the untouchable. The untouchable and the OBCs are the only one which were engaged in the production. They produce for the country, both agriculture as well as non-agriculture production. And the other benefited at their cost. So there is the reparations, the argument is that if somebody benefit at your cost, the one who benefits should compensate. So the government has to develop the policy to increase the ownership of land. Government has a program. One, we must remember that without him naming it as reparation or compensation, government had the schemes for improving the ownership of agricultural land, improving the entrepreneurship, but in a very, very elementary level. There has to be a comprehensive program of compensation in ownership of land and entrepreneurship and education with a time-bound manner as a one-time solution. And second solution I will suggest is that we will have to have the policy for the private sector where bulk of the jobs are there, bulk of the industries are there, and some sort of an affirmative action policy, which is a legal policy, we have to build up. I think these are some of the thought I wanted to share with you, and I will end by thanking you once again.
Thank you very much, Professor Thorat. This is a very enlightening talk. We are now taking questions from the audience. Members of the Brown community can also ask their questions, can maybe flag it in the chat and I can call you out. There are some questions already in the chat, but Professor Vashni, if you would like to comment.
Thank you, Professor Thorat, for this encyclopedic overview. I have a question about not about the current political economy, where it'll be very hard to disagree with you. I think the idea that that two-thirds roughly of the outcomes today can be explained with reference to asset ownership and etc. And one-third easily or more looking at discriminatory practices. So yes, thank you for laying it out so clearly. The historical question, and you perhaps would be in a better position to answer it than most of us, because how much you've read about this, starting with Rig Veda and then Manu. When we look at, you use the term slavery, I think it's very clear that untouchability essentially meant absence of any rights for all practical purposes, absence of any rights. And whatever untouchables got was on the basis of a certain moral code, however unequal that was, and whether it should be called moral code itself is a question, or social norms, or simply the acts of kindness, if at all there were acts of kindness on the part of the upper caste. But there were no, basically the point is there were no rights. Yeah. Now, when it comes to slavery, and I don't know what we can say about the ancient period, but when we talk about the medieval period, on which we have a lot of data from, for example, from America, American slavery, which I'm partly studying these days as part of my ethnic and racial conflict work. The term slavery here in America means the following, and tell me how much it applies to Dalits in India, and at what time, in the earlier, in the ancient time, or in 7th century onwards, 1619 onwards, when slavery was practiced in America. The slave was actually the property of the slave owner. He was defined legally and normatively as the property of the slave owner. He was bought and sold in slave markets. And I've actually been to some former slave markets in Alabama. I've seen them myself, where the sale took place, the buying and selling took place. And so long as slavery was there, apart from the menial agricultural work such as cotton picking in the South, of course, the slave were domestic workers and lived in the compounds of slave owners. Lived in the compound, they were domestic workers. Now, the reason I'm asking you whether in medieval times, 16th century, 15th century onwards, whatever we know about the ancient times, and you could enlighten us on that, whether Dalits were owned as property, that they had no rights is certainly true. But whether they were owned as property, bought and sold by the owners, whether they were owned as property, and whether they ever lived in the compound of the owner, as opposed to segregated. Now, segregation, comprehensive segregation on racial lines is a post-slavery situation for all practical purposes. Once slavery ended in 1864, and Jim Crow laws emerged in the 1890s, reached their full formalization by 1900, that's when black neighborhoods, black businesses, black churches, all black schools, they were all segregated. They were all segregated. Of course, schools did not matter until 1860, empirically speaking, because in 1860, the literacy rate of African Americans was only 5%. Before the onset of civil war. It rises to something like 10% in 1875 or so. So to summarize, then the question is, can the term slave, slavery, at least in the American sense, I'm not sure whether the term means something else in Europe, but in the American sense, it's very clear, they were owned as property and bought and sold in markets. And I've gone through some of the actually advertisements that people used to put out for buying and selling. I've gone through some of those, and I've been to those, and there's a lot of literature available on how the transaction took place. How would you react to this? So I'm not asking anything about absence of rights. That's very clear. No rights for Dalits. Yeah. But what about ownership of Dalits as property and buying and selling?
Okay, shall I respond to this?
Yeah.
Well, you are very right that we both are learning. And you have begun to read this on this issue. On our part, we are also trying to learn now. Me and Amit Thorat, we are having a project on reparation with respect to the untouchable. And as you rightly said, untouchability as a kind of slavery is one of the argument for reparation. But also untouchable being a slave caste is also an independent argument. Mm-hmm. Now, in this connection, Ashutosh, I would like to share with you that I have gone through a huge literature. I am yet to learn and absorb on slavery in India. Now, before I go to the slavery part of it, the specific question that you have asked, I would suggest that Dr. Ambedkar has two essays. One is in volume five, Untouchability and Slavery. There are 2-3 essays, and he draws a distinction between the two. But in volume 12, in fact, he redefines slavery. He has given his own definition of slavery, and then discuss about the slavery in USA, slavery in Roman time, and slavery in India. So that is one part of it. But to answer your question, from the literature that we have gone through and the literature that is now available, is that the untouchable were considered as a slave caste. The first point before that I go to the untouchable, we must agree that there has been a what is called Hindu slavery. Manu recognized 7 slaves, Narada recognized 15 slaves. And that slavery, Hindu slavery, has continued till the Britishers banned it in 1843. The Hindu slavery has continued almost for 2,500 years, even during the Mughal period, but in a different way it continued. So that fact should be accepted, that the Hindu slavery has been there And this is also, Hindu slavery is also a graded slavery. The graded slavery is that the Kshatriya can be a slave of Brahmin, or Vaishya can be a slave of Kshatriya, or the Shudra can be a slave of Vaishya, but a Brahmin cannot be a slave of Kshatriya or Vaishya. So there is a graded slavery. But the untouchable being at the bottom of the caste system, they were slave for all the caste, particularly the Brahmin. So by that notion of the graded slavery itself, the untouchable turned out to be a slave caste, because their main job is to serve the high caste, particularly the Brahmin. It is written in the Manusmriti. But they are also required to serve the other caste. So by implication, you can see that the untouchable became a slave caste. But beyond implication, now it has been sufficiently clear that the slavery, the American type of slavery, was very much a practice during the in India. The only evidence that we have is that of British period. We have not studied the Mughal period or for that matter, ancient period. But ancient period slavery, you will get from R.S. Sharma, who were Shudras. You will get from Vivekananda Jha, who has recently published a book, brought out a book on Chandala. And Sabira Jaiswal has a foreword to that book. Now, let me because I should not take more time on this. There are two books now. One is book by, I don't remember his name. He's with CDS, Center for Developing Society. Oxford has brought out a book just 2 years before. It is on slavery of the untouchable. There is another book, a study on slavery in Kerala. So the South Indian slavery, the way they describe, it is just on par with the slavery that you have in USA. The untouchables were considered as a slave. They were purchased and sold. Their families were separated the way the blacks, mother and son and husband, were separated. And of course, they being an untouchable, untouchability being a unique dimension to the slavery. They being untouchable, they were not allowed to work in the household. In the household, they were slaves, but they were of a different caste other than the untouchable. The untouchable slaves were engaged basically in agriculture. That is why there is a huge article on agro slavery in India, all soil slavery. They used to stay in the farmhouse. They had a small hut there. They will live there. They will work there at a very, very abysmally low wages. And it was more cruel slavery than the slavery that we find in US. Because of untouchability. So I think I would not like to go into that. The answer is yes, that the classical slavery, where you purchase the slave and sell the slave as a property, and the slave doesn't have any right over himself or herself, and then renting out the slaves, earning money on the slave, separating the families, and the atrocities, whenever the slave is sold in the agreement, it is written, I don't remember now, either you save him or kill him, that kind of statement. Many slaves have been killed and punished very, very heavily. Cutting of nose was the common practice in Kerala. Now, this is the story of the South India. In 1840 or 18 earlier to that, the British government set up a commission. It is called a commission to detect the slavery, because there was a huge movement in England against the slavery in India, because slavery in West Indies had gone, USA slavery had gone. So there was a movement which was primarily started by the Christian missionaries. And so the British government set up a commission called Law Commission. And that Law Commission studied the slavery in other parts of India and came to the conclusion that the kind of the slavery that we observed in South India is also the case for other slavery in other part, there with some variation. So other part means Bengal, Madhya Pradesh, Bihar, Orissa, Maharashtra, Rajasthan. So the slavery was not a phenomenon of South India alone, where there is a very, very clear evidence, but there is also, the slavery was an all India phenomenon. If you read the Law Commission report for the West Bengal, there is a chapter on caste and slavery. Which caste are the slave? Their prices of the untouchable slave was lower than that of high caste slave. the remuneration was much less. So these are the insights that we got from our study, which we will bring out eventually, me and Amit Thorat. There will be an article, comprehensive article on the 10 countries on reparation very soon, I think by October. But the bigger study will come much later.
Thank you.
We have a couple of more questions. Can I ask Julia Buccioni, who's in the economics department, also to ask her question?
Yes. First of all, thank you so much, Professor Thorat. I have a question that follows up a bit on this discussion on slavery and related to caste system in India. At the moment, I'm studying the Arab slave trade, and we can see that during the Arab slave trade, there was a clear moment that brought some, like the birth of racial discrimination in the Middle East that was mostly exempt from racial distinctions. And it was when like the white slave trade started to die out, and so only black slaves started to be imported in the Middle East. And so the disappearance of white slaves, this change in the demographic composition of slaves, brought the start of this of racial discrimination or racial prejudices. And I was wondering if in the past there was something like a demographic change or a demographic shock that can be associated with the emergence of this of the caste system or the starting of prejudices against ethnically distinct people. Thank you.
Well, you know, I'm not a student of slavery in that sense of the term. It is an experiment, very recent experiment. But I give a credit to the Indian historian that they have really studied this phenomena of slavery. Channa was the first one to have studied the slavery in greater detail. From what you say, there is a caste base to slavery. And if you consider ethnicity as an equated with the caste, social origin, then in that sense, definitely there is a cultural dimension, ethnic dimension, and the caste dimension. Color, I am not quite sure, because you had the slave in South India, which are as black as the Brahmins were or the middle caste were, and you have the slave in Northern India, they were as fair and as white as the higher caste. So I cannot say that there is a racial base to the slavery in India as such. But caste, yes. This is not to say that there are no slavery. There were no slave of other than the untouchable. There were, but they were mostly domestic slave. And the slave in during Mughal period, they were engaged in the artisans occupation as such.
Thank you so much.
There is another question that may be very pertinent is by Dr. S. Abdul Taha. He's asking, there is a discussion required whether to equate the problem of African Americans with Dalits or with Muslims in India. One opinion comes that historically we can equate with Dalits, but for contemporary discriminations, Indian Muslims also fall into this category, unfortunately. Professor Thorat, if you could shed some light on this.
The discrimination, the way we define, you know, unequal treatment of equal on the basis of the identity. And that identity range from gender, color, indigenous background, ethnicity, social origin, occupation origin, Africa. So the discrimination takes place because of identity, of various type of identity. I mean, there are a number of theories on identity theory of discrimination. So to that extent, there is a similarity between the African-American and untouchables. In fact, there is a huge similarity between the African-American and the untouchable. And therefore, you will find that untouchable have taken many things from the African-American. Dalit Panther movement, or Dalit literature, or gender discourse. Dalit feminism's idea is coming up now, drawing quite a lot from the African feminism. So there is certainly a similarity, but there are differences also we must understand. Now, as far as the comparison of Dalit with Muslim is concerned, we cannot make a comparison simply because there is no enough literature on discrimination about the Muslim. Discrimination that I am talking about, discrimination in social sphere, discrimination in cultural sphere, but much more predominantly discrimination in economic sphere, in employment and businesses and the farming. There is the evidence on inequality. There is inequality between the Hindus and the Muslim with respect to certain indicators. For example, the proportion of Muslim in regular salaried job in private sector is much lower. Even in public sector is much lower. They are heavily concentrated in self-employment. Educational level is also much lower among the Muslim. Only 14% GER at the higher education level compared to 38% or 40% among the high caste. So there are inequalities that I can understand between Hindu and Muslim. But we don't have an empirical evidence on the nature and the form of discrimination faced by the Muslim so that we can compare with the Dalit. There are very recently only people have begun to talk about discrimination. So I would not say that that there are huge similarity between the Dalit and the Muslim as such because of the lack of the evidence. Even there are no studies on OBC who are entitled for the reservation, and they do face some sort of a discrimination, but there are no study whatsoever. Dalit studies, also studies on Dalit in economic discrimination, is of a very recent origin to 10, 11 years. The economic theories of caste discrimination, I will share with Ashutosh Varsane, that all the three people who have written, they are from US. Akerlof, theories of caste. Then the Scovely, who is from Minnesota. And Deepak Lal, who has never stayed in India. He, most of the time he spent. These are the three people who have developed a theory of economic theory of caste. Not a single economist from India, however great they are, they are really great, has not applied their mind to the question of caste discrimination.
Thank you, Professor Thoradin. And I think that is why it was important to have a discussion about caste, particularly in economics, because this is a discipline with so many economists from Indian origin, but with an extreme poverty of good work on caste. The next question sort of relates to the policy recommendation that you had talked about some sort of reparations and creating a level playing field for the untouchables. Alok Kumar, it's a comment, but maybe it should be read in the light of your policy recommendation could be read in the light of this comment, which is that now the new notion of reservation is for poverty eradication in upper caste. So they demand reservation on the basis of economy. So I'm just wondering if the policy recommendation that you have presented could be sort of misread into the demand for reservations, affirmative action on the basis of economic position rather than caste. And if you think that's a dangerous move, especially that has happened in the recent times.
If you go by the history, the affirmative action policy of various type, I do recall that during 2003 or 4, when privatization move was initiated by Dr. Manmohan Singh, and at that time, there was a debate, and we were given a study, my institute, to study the international experience. Private sector was positive for some kind of an affirmative action. So we did a study, and I came across about 110 countries. Now, if you look at this, all 10 countries and their affirmative action policy, USA, Northern Ireland, Japan, Malaysia, South Africa, and many other countries, New Zealand. The affirmative action policy with various names, you know, USA equal opportunity policy, Northern Ireland equal employment policy, Japan called special measure, the UK call it a wider participation very recently. It's all different name, but the essence is the same. And that essence is that the affirmative action policies, which also include the legal safeguard against discrimination, are specifically developed or government failed are necessary for those communities those group which are discriminated on the basis of their identity. And therefore, they require a special protection. They require a protection, legal protection against discrimination. You have a law against untouchability, a law against racism. If somebody faces discrimination, you can go to your court of law. So you have a protection of law against discrimination. But it was also found that the law by itself doesn't ensure the fair share in the economy, in various fields, because the decisions are taken by the people in employment, in entrepreneurship, and in the farming. Therefore, discrimination denied them equal participation. Therefore, the policies were developed whereby some sort of an visible share or fair share is given to them in employment, in education institution, in farming, in entrepreneurships. Now, how do you define fairness? That is another story. It is defined differently in different countries. We in India, we define fair share in proportion to population. In USA, it is called disparate impact or disparate proportion. There are other districts. So the affirmative action policies are anti-discriminatory policy. Obviously, they cannot be applied. They should not be applied, in my view, for the poor. For poor, the policy is a general policy. You are poor because you are illiterate. You are poor because you don't have means of production. And therefore, your income is low. So it is a general problem of poverty which cut across all castes, cut across everybody. And therefore, there are pro-poor policies to elevate the poverty through different ways. This is not to say that the government should not take a decision to give a priority to the poor, a special assistance to the poor. Yes, indeed. Poor need a support. Poor need a preference. But the ground cannot be discrimination. The affirmative action policies are only for those groups who suffer discrimination, and they require law as well as a special step to give them the fair share. So the attempt here in India to bring an economic criteria for reservation is, in my view, is misplaced. And that is why the reservation policy has blurred the difference between the two. I give you one example, and I will stop on this question. What is the difference between the pro-poor policy and affirmative action policy? Illiteracy is, for example, the reason for both, for scheduled caste as well as the high caste, whereby they do not have enough employability, so they don't get a job. So you provide education to the both, give them the primary, secondary, and higher education. And then you say, we have provided equal opportunity, that's fine. And then leave it, place them in the market. What happened? In the market, the high caste person will get a preference advantage of his caste. In fact, in my presentation, we have also measured the percentage of advantage because of caste factor and disadvantage because of caste factor. But I won't be in that complication here. But it is quite obvious that the high caste, once enter into the market or into the school, they will prefer the high caste teacher or, let's take employed, they get a preference. And that is how you find the caste-wise concentrations of employment. I would not like to name the industrial group and their percentage of worker by the caste. We have that statistic for few industries. So the high caste would get an advantage and benefit. Scheduled caste, on the other hand, even if equally qualified, my study shows, which shows, has referred to, even if equally qualified, he or she may not get a call. Even if they get a call, they may not be appointed. Now, both are equally qualified. So the scheduled caste and discriminated group will require an additional policy, a supplementary policy, a complementary policy in addition to the policy of educational development. And that is that they are not discriminated legal protection. That is that they get a fair share in employment. So you have to have some mechanism whereby you ensure the share. In India, population share. In other countries, indifferent share. I tell you the story of Northern Ireland. In Northern Ireland, what do they do in private sector? There is an employment equal opportunity office. There is a discrimination of Catholic vis-a-vis Protestant. So the Northern Ireland, they will look at this, take the survey of the industries and look at their denomination, Catholic or Protestant. In an area where the Catholics are in larger majority, if their share in the worker is less, a polite letter is sent to the industry that the Catholics are underrepresented and Protestants are highly represented. The industry, particular firm, will shake to the core because if that letter find place in the newspaper, then they are scared. Therefore, they will make correction. Now, that's a voluntary policy, but there is a policy, and proportion of population is taken into account. So I think that is my answer to this question, that poor need to be helped, but you identify the disadvantage of the poor and give them the share and give them the preference, no problem. But you cannot use the affirmative action policy, which is based on discrimination. Because that is why we are trying to confuse in India by bringing economic criteria. There is a political reason for that. There's a whole political agenda. That being economic discrimination, the economic criteria, there are elite, there are crimilaire that have come up among the scheduled castes, exclude the crimilaire. Now, is the discrimination independent of economic standing? We have studied in this, the evidence that I have given to you, that in the private sector, the discrimination is at the top hierarchy, not at the lower hierarchy. Discrimination is based on your caste and ethnicity and your religious background, gender background. It is not based on your economic standing. Mm-hmm. So you're relatively economically better off scheduled caste. If they face discrimination, you will refuse to give them the legal protection and the fair share. So there has been a political attempt, even on the part of the academician, those who are interested, those who are, whosoever asking the question, I will recommend my article in EPW 2 years before 2016, Prejudice Against Reservation Policy, Why and How. So there are many questions that I have answered. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Right. There is a related question to this, which is from Akash Raj. He's asking, having endowments helps in escaping caste discrimination to an extent due to the primary characterization of caste with respect to economic standing. So could it be assumed that capitalism in this aspect is helping to fight caste discrimination by providing a limited safeguard?
No, I didn't understand the question, but the way I understood it, I will try to answer. The all theories of economic discrimination, market discrimination, are based on the understanding that market discriminate. Market do not recognize only merit. Market do recognize merit, but it also recognizes the identity of the person who seek job. The first theory of economics of discrimination was given by Gary Becker, and he argued that in a competitive market, discrimination would not prevail. Because a firm who discriminate will suffer losses and will be out. So if you introduce competition in the market, there won't be a discrimination. But the later theories and evidence show that discrimination persists even in a competitive market. A country like USA, there are several sectors which are highly competitive and yet discrimination is there. There is enough evidence of that. So the competition in the economy does not guarantee that discrimination will not be practiced. But at the same time, there are progressive features of the market and capitalism. Those progressive features are that long distance trade, impersonal trade, and many other things. People value price. If the price is low, I will buy. If the price is high, I will sell. So the market has also progressive aspect which erode the discrimination to a certain extent. But from this, we should not follow, logically, we should not conclude that market itself will take care of discrimination. No. Market will, discrimination will remain because the basis of discrimination is prejudice, material benefit, preference for my own people, my caste, my color, my gender. So you do require the affirmative action policy which focus on the group.
We have two very important questions that have just come up. The first one is from Jyoti. She is asking, can we talk of a Dalit feminist standpoint that assumes the existence of Dalit patriarchy? Have the Dalits had the kind of property or other material conditions for the protection of which a Dalit patriarchy can be said to have emerged?
Well, this is a question which is genuinely the area of political science and gender studies. I don't have a deep understanding, but whatever I read, I will share my thinking with you. There is a book by, Sunaina Arya, who is a PhD student in philosophy, and co-author is Akash Rathod, Dalit Patriarchy. And there is other literature also, because I am associated with all several women Dalit organizations, so I know their mind and their debate and their argument vis-a-vis the mainstream feminism. I think what Dalit feminism and patriarchy talk about is the following. Dalit feminist think writers do recognize that there is an issue of gender discrimination within the family. There is an issue of male and female discrimination there. Some of those who have done empirical study, like Gopal Guru and others, they would argue that in the working class, the gender issue is a little less than in the non-working class. If you take, I don't want to name the caste in India, but those castes where the women do not work with the men in the field, there the gender domination and other thing will be much relatively stronger than that of the scheduled caste and Dalit women who work along with the men. And therefore in Rajasthan, you can see that they are smoking together, bidi, and eating together. So the working condition, the fact that you are a laborer, you work with your husband, you tend to enjoy automatically certain rights more than the others. But at the same time, there are within the Dalit families and with the Dalit community, there are certain issue related to gender. It may be violence, it may be share in the power, it may be property right. You have a property right now, but you may not claim it simply because girls are not supposed to claim property right. But I do not know how many studies are there on gender issues, but the issue exists. But the Dalit woman, while agree the gender issue and patriarchy, similar to that of the mainstream feminism, they also disagree with them. That caste is an additional dimension to the Dalit feminism and Dalit female problem. There are specific institutions like Devdasi. There are other institutions which are only confined to scheduled caste. They are not confined to higher caste. So the caste bring an additional dimension to Dalit woman's problem. There was a seminar just before your seminar, our seminar started. I was participating into the release of the report on atrocities. And there's a special section on atrocities on Dalit woman and sexual violence against them. So you could see that the Dalit woman, woman face a huge sexual violence from the high caste. And there is a much difference between the high caste woman and the scheduled caste woman. So the Dalit woman, Dalit women are arguing that you have to combine patriarchy with the caste. And then there are some who go ahead and say that the caste discrimination and the violation of denial of property right and other right all boil down to the class. That you don't have property right, that you have less education and you tend to be poor. So they are talking of triple exploitation, gender, patriarchy, caste and economics. So that is the discourse by and large that I have understood from the literature that is available on Dalit patriarchy and Dalit feminism.
Perhaps we can take one last question because it had come before. Hillary is asking that caste in India is grounded in religion. How had the political rise of Hindutva affected Dalits? Would you say that things have improved economically? But what about violence under the Modi government?
Coming to the woman's position in Hinduism, I won't say Hinduism. You know, we cannot equate Hinduism with the Brahmanism, Vedic Brahmanism particularly. Hinduism is a concept, which was a geographical concept given by Albuni. You know, the people living beyond Sindh, he called Hindu. But the Hindu as aism emerged in after the arrival of the British. Consolidation of Hinduism, I think Ashutosh knows about the work of Christopher Chepperlet. And then the ism came largely because of Savarkar. But the people like Lal Mani Joshi and others would argue that Hindus comprise all ideological and religious thought. And Vedic Brahmanism and the non-Brahmin philosophies, you have Sikhism, you have Buddhism, you have Jainism, there was a Bhakti traditional movement and many other thought. That diversity of thought comprised Hinduism. But now today, the attempt is that on the name of Hinduism, only Brahmanical Hinduism is being promoted. So that difference should be there, should be drawn. Women's lost their rights. Women did not have right to education and right to property and other rights in a Brahmanical Hinduism or Brahmanical Vedism, you can say. It's very clear. In Manusmriti, it is written in many others. So I need not give. But those who want to have a clarity on this, those who ask me the question, there is an article by Dr. Ambedkar, Rise and Fall of Hindu Woman. And he brought the Hindu Code Bill when he was a law minister. So he explained there how Manu was responsible for the downfall of woman and how Buddha was responsible for elevating the woman, giving them religious right, giving them educational right and spiritual right. So the connection between the Brahmanism, Vedic Brahmanism and loss of right by woman is quite clear. And irrespective of the caste background, Brahmin woman, middle class woman, Dalit woman, all. That is one. The second question is the situation of the Dalit in the contemporary time. I think their situation is not quite good. If we take the, for example, 2-3 areas, if we take the policies, there are several policies which have been taken by the government and brought changes in the policies, which are detrimental to the scheduled caste. You know, some of the policies are reverted now because of the pressure of the Dalit. For example, when privatization move was initiated by Dr. Manmohan Singh and we went to and met him that privatization will lead to de-reservation, what do we do? Have something for private sector. He took an initiative and the private sector, after 5 years of debate, accepted the affirmative action policy that is called voluntary voluntary and self-regulatory policy. Now, this government has been privatizing at a rate at which we have not seen privatization. It doesn't utter a single word that what will happen to the reservation, what will happen to the employment of scheduled caste in public sector undertaking. So there is no sensitivity. On the contrary, some of them say that there is intention, in fact, to privatize is to reduce the reservation. I will not take that argument. We assume that privatization is for economic reason, although it is very difficult to understand. We are privatizing some of our Navratna, that is those who are earning profit, they are also being privatized. So we don't know. The reason seems to be ideological, not economic. But the impact on the scheduled caste on reservation is never discussed. There are several changes in the special component plan. There are several changes in the education policy which focus on the Dalit. When I was chairman of the UGC, 32 Center for Social Exclusion and Inclusion Study were set up by us. And these centers were doing wonderfully well. Some of them were working on tribal, some of them on scheduled caste, some of them on Muslim minorities. The all entire money has been withdrawn. Letter has been issued that these centers, as far as the support from UGC is concerned, it is gone. Now, so you don't want to promote research on the areas which are neglected areas. I do not want to say anything, but research in social science has gone in a different direction. But there are other issues besides policies. Special component policy also there are changes. They have changed the name and many other things. Difficult to catch, camouflaging, you know. But on the issue of atrocities, the atrocities and violence has indeed increased from 1914 to 2020. And I had written an article in Indian Express and given a statistic statewide. In those states which are ruled by the Britishers, by the BJP, the atrocities rate was very high, and the violence of a different type has increased. You know the case of Ahmedabad, and you know the case of attack on women, particularly. The report that we have released about today, the sexual violence and physical attack on women have increased, enhanced, and the kind of atrocities, you know. Mass attack in the full view of the public. Ahmedabad incidents and many others. So the nature of atrocities have also changed, which gives you linkage with the cultural dimension. I tried to explain why does it happen? Why atrocities are increasing? My explanation was that we have brought some moral support to the issues of discrimination and the situation of Dalit earlier. Now I see a change. there is a very indirect boost to the ideology. We support hierarchy, we support caste system. You take the incidences of incidences or utterances against caste system, against constitution, and count them before 2014 and during after 2014. You can see many more. Burning of constitution by the youth from Bihar. And we have never seen a movement before save the constitution. What is the necessity? Why people began to respect constitution? Why people are trying to embrace constitution? They want the constitution. They're a movement. So there is an ideology which is coming up, which is not in conformity with the principle of the constitutions, which also indirectly talk against reservation, talk about those who oppose caste system. As a result, there is a general ideological boost to the ideology which believe in caste in a way. And as a result, the discrimination has increased, atrocities have increased. Very difficult to establish the link, but nevertheless, there is a link.
Thank you so much, Professor Thorat. This was a very enlightening talk, and we all learned a lot. And I think that's it. So
let me also add my thanks to Professor Thorat for his very enlightening seminar talk, and thanks to Arushi for organizing it, for curating it. We will pick up some of the themes that have been brought to attention, because this is not a one-off event, discussion of discrimination against Dalits and against other groups which might have been marginalized, have been marginalized in the economy, in society. And we will continue our conversation through the year. But many, many thanks, Professor Thorat.
No, pleasure. It was nice to see you and
very good
really
you.
Interact with the very, very interesting group. I look forward to interact. Yeah. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you.